we're kicking it off. It's the Frog Pants Plays news update, and it should be fun. Let's hope so. Who knows? Don't actually know, but it should be. All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Frog Pants News Update. I'm Scott Johnson, and today is our first attempt at doing this. Super simple stuff here. We're not making a big formal podcast out of this, at least not yet. If we do, I'll be sure that you guys are the first to know, but this is a stream-only deal. We'll do it after TMS in the mornings, possibly on Friday as well. Haven't determined that yet. Big shout-out goes to Alex Albisu, who is helping me out with production duties, helping me gather stories, getting stuff done, and putting the sheets before I get to it in the next morning. It's going to be great working with him on this, so huge thanks to him. This is going to be a little bit unusual because it's not super formal. There are no guests per se, well, other than you guys, because I'm going to take your phone calls. And that's going to be a real easy thing to do. So if you are into calling me, it's 801-471-0462. And you can respond to these conversations we're having about these games or the news that's happening today or anything you feel like talking about. I'm here for you. Probably going to put today's audio up on the mega feed, Frog Pants mega feed. So for those who do want to get it, that's an easy way to get it. All right, we should just jump right in. So that's how it's going to work. 801-471-0462 is the number. You're encouraged to call in if you would like to call in. Again, if you don't want to call in, that's okay too. Nothing here is required other than hopefully we have a good time with each other. All right, let's get to it. First up, Atari VCS is getting thousands of retro games. How do you guys feel about that? You know that Atari thing, right? Are you into it? I'm not. I wish I was, but I kind of am not too into it. At least not the Atari side of things, because I don't really care that much about Atari games. I was a kid. Most of my friends had an Atari 2600. That sort of stuff was not interesting to me at all at the time. And not so much now either. I always found it blocky and boring. So the VCS hasn't held much interest for me, except they announced on Monday that it's teaming up with Ant Stream Arcade to provide an exclusive edition of Ant Stream Arcade's streaming service for the new Atari VCS. Have you not heard of Ant Stream? I hadn't either until this story cropped. This exclusive edition offers more than 2,000 officially licensed games. This includes 50 exclusive Atari titles at launch, with more exclusives coming in the future. Which answers one question about the device being upgradable, or being able to add stuff to it. I think there was an assumption that was the case, but this is not just another Genesis Mini or freaking Super Nintendo Mini or anything to that regard. It is specifically designed to be a device that carries on and that you'll be able to put new stuff on it. There was talk in the early days that you could put modern day indie games on there, or even modern day AAA titles on there, that it would be basically a PC and be capable of running a lot more, but I don't know how that stuff's panned out. Anyway, here's how it's going to go. You're going to get Knight Driver, Pong, and Yar's Revenge. Yar's Revenge may be the only good 2600 game ever to exist, although combat's okay, I guess. The price for this service is $9.99 per month. That's $9.99 per month, or $7.99 per month if you agree to an annual contract. You also get 1 month upfront for free. I'm just going to put this out there. That is a ridiculous price. That is too high, and there's no chance in hell I am paying $10 a month for this service. Not while there are many other services, even in video games, for a lot less money. For example, the brand new Apple Arcade with some pretty great exclusive content. Got to be in the Apple world, I guess, to enjoy it, but not bad. Play it with a controller, do whatever you got to do. That's $4.99 a month, and up to 5 people can play it. Or, I don't know, even my Switch with its... Where is my Switch? It's not here. For $3.99 a month, I get access to all these old NES and Super NES games, plus a ton of real, you know, great games, the typical stuff that you love from Nintendo. Like, that's a better deal. Microsoft's Game Pass is a better deal, sort of across the board. So why would I pay $10 a month for old arcade old Atari games, which, you know, just isn't that interesting to me. There's the device, by the way. Chat room, you can see it. Controller, joystick. Does not, as far as I know, come with both those joysticks. I think it just comes with one. Nah, I could be wrong on that. That may have changed too, but anyway. It's cool looking. I like the look of it, you know? Retro but new, kind of. Controller seems okay. The one that's like a normal controller, but the stick has always been bad, so I don't know who wants that. Clearly somebody does, but anyway, time will tell on this thing and whether or not you or me are going to be interested in paying $10 a month for the Atari VCS coming under a television near you. All right, what else is going on? PS Plus in October has some pretty good offers. Okay, so we're in October, October 1st today, by the way. Let's take a look at what we've got. If you have a PS Plus membership and you have the opportunity to play one of the most highly acclaimed titles out there, you're going to get Last of Us Remastered. That is coming with PS Plus this month. And if you never played Last of Us, good time to do it. This is smart of Sony. They know they have a reasonable amount of players who probably never got into the first one, and that second one is coming out. Maximize your sales of the second one by pushing the first one out again and doing it under PlayStation Plus, which has, for the most part, been a pretty good service, and at least it has been for me. Do you guys see the new trailer for Last of Us 2 last week? I thought it was a Red Dead trailer. I thought it was Red Dead DLC because they're on horses and they're in the snow. What else am I supposed to expect from these chuckleheads? Anyway, it looked good. I don't know if I'm going to play it. Controversial opinion. Here we go. Get ready for an unpopular one. Last of Us never grabbed me. And it has all the things I should like. It's got post-apocalypticness. It's got zombie things. I like zombies. I'm into it. I'm not so much into scary games, but, you know, this game was more about story than it was scares, or about jump scares anyway. And it just never grabbed me. I don't know why. I don't know what it was about it that just never caught on for me. And so I don't really care about a sequel, even though I feel like I should. This feels bad. Like, I realize this is bad. And Naughty Dog's never let me down. I love the Uncharted games. Loved them. Adored them. Is it a me thing? Does anyone agree? Anyone out there feel this way? Because I feel like I'm a little alone in this. Understandably so. Oh, there's a couple in there saying I'm not the only one. You know, it's a weird thing in video games. Like, there's a tendency for us to be expected to all like the same shit, right? So we're supposed to all love Zelda. We're supposed to all love, I don't know, I'm trying to think of another one. Another one that's just supposed to be universally beloved. Can't think of one. But there are plenty of those, right? Where you're supposed to just love it. Skyrim, there's a good example. One of the greatest games. I love Skyrim, so this isn't me saying I didn't like Skyrim. But it's possible that people don't like it, right? And it's hard for us to get our heads around the idea that a thing we hold in such great regard is dismissed by somebody as being, not for me, or average, or whatever. That could be genres. I feel that way about tower defense. I feel that way about anything with an escort mission. I feel that way about anything with a timer associated with it. I hate timers. Timers can bite me. So there are going to be people out there that don't like anything. Like the chat just said, let's see, Miramichi CD says, I don't like anything with zombies in it. Fair enough. I like zombies in my video games, so I'm kind of cool with it. We got to get better, though, at accepting that each other may have different, slightly different ideas than the dude next to us, and that's okay. But anyway, Last of Us 2 coming. Last of Us Remastered now available. Maybe I should just buckle down and play it and try again. It's supposed to be the game of a generation. And yet here I am not loving it as much as I thought I would. Anyway, there's also a free game lineup for MLB The Show 19, which is a pretty good game. If you like baseball, in fact, as far as I'm concerned, if you like baseball, it is the only game that's any good these days. here's some more notes about that stuff. But the show is awesome. And if you've never played it or played one of the show games, they're really, really good. I prefer my baseball games a little more arcadey. So I'm not so much into the sim aspect of those kinds of games. But as far as who's doing it the best right now, I think those guys are doing it the best. And it happens to be a Sony exclusive. And those are free games for PlayStation Plus coming this October. Which we're already in. How many hours are we in? We're almost 11 hours into the new day or the new month. Let the Halloween celebration begin. Anyway, if you want to call and have any comments or thoughts about any of what we talked about today, again, I got to start pounding this number in you guys so you start using it. 801-471-0462. Take advantage of the fact that this is a live show and that you can have your voice heard right here on the air. 801-471-0462. All right. Gearbox wouldn't go union for Borderlands 3. So Troy Baker, speaking of Last of Us, he played what's his name? Who's the main guy in Last of Us? Can't think of his name. Help me, help me. Can you guys remember? Greg? Larry, Bob, Richard, Joel. It's Joel. Thank you, chat room. Yeah, he played Joel. Anyway, because Borderlands 3 and the Gearbox Studio would not go union, Troy Baker wouldn't voice Ryze or Reese in the story. He refused to do it. It was originally reported that Gearbox CEO Randy Pitchford, reported by CEO Randy Pitchford. The storied Randy Pitchford. Randy Pitchford with his errant USB drive full of questionable pornography left at a restaurant. I'm not saying anything negative here. This is all known stuff. Pitchford's weird. Anyway, not weird, but there's stuff going on with Pitchford. Anyway, he says he didn't reprise this role because of Telltale Games, Tales from the Borderlands, because he turned down the role. A new article from Polygon reports that Baker didn't reprise the role when it came to this third edition of Borderlands because the company refused to go union, meaning they wouldn't honor the wages, contract terms, and benefits that are associated with SAG-AFTRA. And as you know, voice actors a couple years ago took a major stand on this issue and basically refused to do stuff that wasn't union protected. They made a big deal out of it. There was a strike. Do you guys remember the video game voice actor strike? That was a thing. That happened. Anyway. Oh, yeah, that's right, Dice Tomato. Gearbox and Homeworld 3. Homeworld 3 got funded, right? Didn't they crowdfund that? I forgot they own that now. That's interesting. My expectation for Homeworld 3 is high, but also Gearbox is spotty. They have a spotty record. People are enjoying Borderlands 3, I know. I couldn't get into it, though. I can't do it. I paid BL2 so long and so hard that I don't think I can do it. I can't even look at 3 and get excited. Because I'm just like, that looks like a lot more of the thing I did for hundreds of hours. So I can't do it. The Wraith says, wasn't the replacement actor for this also in the union? I don't know. I don't know who it is. That's an interesting bent to this. So I'd have to learn more. But anyway, Baker remarks about this whole issue that this is quite a disappointment since it was the expectation all along that the characters from Tales of the Borderlands would be part of the larger Borderlands universe and that his union dues wouldn't be a problem. So it's not happening now. It didn't happen. He's not in it. And I don't know. Nobody's really singing the praises about the story. I haven't heard anybody playing Borderlands 2, 3 that's like, oh, the story. They like the gameplay loop, and that's cool. But I haven't heard anybody saying much else. Chat room, if you have thoughts, that's why that phone number's there. Like this call. Oh my gosh, we got a call. Somebody actually stepped up and said, you know what? I'm going to call into the show. I'm going to let my voice be heard. And that person is right here. Hi, who's this?
Oh, hey, it's Dice Tomato. What's going on?
Hey, buddy. I'm good. How are you this fine morning day thing?
Doing good. So the story on Homeworld 3, mm-hmm. from what I've seen and what I've read. So they had, they put all of their, I guess, marketing materials on this crowdfunding campaign called FIG.
Yeah. Oh, right. The one, yeah, the one that, shoot, is that still going? I guess it is, right?
It ended, I think, Friday or over the weekend at some point.
All right.
But yeah, it got funded all kinds of craziness. But it's, it seems more like an odd like pre-order kind of a setup. And I'm not totally sure if it being funded means that they're actually going to develop it, because, of course, they'll have to go through the motions of development and everything. And their projection currently is, I think, to 2022.
Right. Whoops. I don't know why that's playing. Hold on a second. Sorry, that's not your fault. Oh, this is sure a beta episode of the show. Sorry.
No, you're fine.
Well, that's interesting. So do we know much about, like, part of me wants that game real bad because I love the tone of the world. It's just an amazing thing. I love 2 so much. I loved 1 so much. It's just such a great series. I have concerns, though. My worry is that that game is not going to, it's not going to do anything innovative in the actual gameplay department, and it's just going to be this space RTS again. And for some, that's going to be enough, but I kind of need more than that, I think.
My understanding from all the, I guess, promotional things that they've released so far is that they have a lot of the earlier development teams that were working on 1 and 2 and the remaster back on board. They were talking about looking to do some new innovative gameplay mechanics, but keep a baseline of all the things that at least they thought made Homeworld great, as far as the different weird like little unit quirks and the mechanics of being able to target specific areas of larger capital ships, the 360 degree space field and everything. And I think one, it might have been Pitchford who had said this in one of their little weird interviews, but story is kind of their biggest, their biggest thing that they're focusing on first.
Yeah. I mean, do you think, let me ask you this question, it's a little bit unrelated, and I'm looking at the teaser announcement trailer for 3 right now, and it's got me excited just looking at it, but do you think that Pitchford's odd approach to everything hurts them or helps them? In other words, does having this kind of nuts guy who's behind the scenes and runs everything, does that help that company, or does it put you at dis-ease? Does it make you worry about the games they make or any of that sort of thing, or do you think that's just overblown?
I think it varies.
Yeah. Yeah.
He seems to, I don't know to what depth of involvement he was on the remaster.
Yeah.
But he talks it up like it's the second coming of Christ, which it kind of is in its own right for RTS gameplay.
Yeah.
It was pretty groundbreaking when it came out, and it's still, I mean, there's been nothing that has come as close to its style of gameplay, except for maybe like Sins of the Solar Empire.
Oh yeah, Sins of the Solar Empire did a pretty good job of sort of replicating that, but it didn't quite hit it. I agree with that. That's an interesting point. Yeah, I don't know. I have high hopes for it. Here's one thing that game did. Once that game showed that you could have these cool trails coming off the back of your ship for like an eternity almost, nobody was doing that. So it was this like weird new look, and now I want all my space games as a result to have awesome like trails behind them. It's a small thing. It's purely this visual thing, but man, I love that. I think that is so cool.
My biggest thing is that I hope they keep that same sort of painted on screen art aesthetic that they really pushed in Deserts of Carrick as well.
Oh yeah. I didn't play that. How was that? Cause you can get that on sale a lot now. It's like a pretty easy to get game. Was it good? Cause it's basically just like
it's good.
Homeworld on the ground kind of.
Pretty much. Yeah. Yeah. That's what it is. It's a prequel. It's sort of they go through the whole, in the beginning of the first Homeworld, 100 years ago, this ship crash landed, blah, 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 blah. That's the storyline they go through in Deserts of Carrick.
Huh.
as the warring tribal peoples of the planet kind of race against the technology that has been found.
Interesting.
It's if you could mix Homeworld with Mad Max a little bit, mm-hmm. it's kind of what Deserts of Carrick is. You'll get that Mad Max gritty vibe.
Okay. All right. You've convinced me to maybe finally pick that thing up. I've always been tempted to because I love that thing. I love that world. I was hoping that that game captured some of that, even though it was ground warfare. Thanks for the call, man. It's been good to talk to you. Have a fantastic rest of your day. And lines are open, folks. If you'd like to call in, you can. That number is 801-471-0462. You can see right there on your screen. There's John Wick presenting it in full animated fashion. All right. Before we go today, I wanted to talk quickly about this Goose Game. Untitled Goose Game. We got a call. I don't know why that rang that way. It wasn't supposed to. Beta, you guys. Beta. We're doing beta here. This is beta testing. We're trying to figure our world out. I got a few things to work out. Hi, you're on the air. Who's this?
Hey, it's Alec Albisa. What's happening?
Hey, what's up, man? Thanks for all your help today, by the way. Good work.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. Hope everybody's enjoying it. Hey, I wanted to throw out a question because we were talking about it a little bit on Twitter. Steve H&H in the chat threw this question out. And is there like a blanket genre that you're looking at and you're like, nah, I can't do that? Because for me, it's a lot of it is like the sports games or racing games. I just kind of look at it and like, unless it's something like Mario Kart where I know kind of what I'm getting.
Yeah,
that's like different. That's like a different type of racing game. Kind of falls in line similar with like Diddy Kong Racing back in the day.
Sure.
Is there a genre that kind of sticks out where you're just like, nah?
Yeah, there is actually. For me, it's more of a subgenre. I don't even actually think you can call it its own genre. But and I bring it up a lot. But anything that claims to be tower defense, I'm out. Even if it has an aspect of tower defense, they say a little bit of tower defense thrown in there. Not interested. Walk away. Don't want anything to do with it. And by that I mean, and I should make this clear because a lot of people would say, well, Wayne, isn't like a MOBA a form of tower defense? Well, there are towers in it and they defend against things, but you're not managing the towers. So what I mean by tower defense is like, oh, there's a path and you've got to build defensive towers up during a phase of the game so that when a big wave of enemies comes, hopefully you made them, right? So they shoot all the dudes. I freaking hate that genre. I can't do it. I also can't do dating sims. Just on the face of it, I can't do them.
Me neither. I just don't understand. Okay, like, no shame to people who love that thing, because I know a lot of people love it.
Yeah.
But it's just not something I got into.
Yeah, I can't do it. And then the third thing. I mean, it used to be, back in the day, I couldn't do Japanese RPGs. They used to drive me crazy, but now I kind of have a taste for them, so I feel like that doesn't count anymore. But what else? Sports and racing I actually like. I like to, especially racing. It depends. Like I do prefer my racing games a little more on the arcade side of things. And that's why, for example, Forza Horizon 4 is so rad, because it's got realistic tendencies, but it's definitely aimed at a more creative driving crowd that's not so worried about every piston and every turn and every, you know, possible setup for your car. It's actually just more about the fun of the world. So I like those kinds of racing games. And then sports games, I've always been fond of a good hockey game. I don't care who makes it. Nobody does them anymore. Well, I guess the NHL series from EA still gets made, but it's like they're not making it for me anymore. They kind of peaked a while ago, and I haven't gotten one in a long time. But man, back in the day, I loved a good hockey game. NHL 94. Long time ago, but that was the best freaking hockey game, and I had it.
That
on my,
was a good hockey game.
I had it on my Genesis, and I had it on my Sega CD. And the CD version was cool because it had real crowd sounds and music. Otherwise, it was the same as Genesis version pretty much after that. But we would play NHL 94 into the wee hours of the morning until our hands were raw. Like, I love those games. It just depends on the sports game. Sometimes a good football game, I'll play Madden here and there. I like a baseball game here and there, but it's not a thing I rush out and get. It's stuff on sale. Or if somebody does like Mutant League hockey style games where they're, you know, or Mutant League football, which I also love both those games. If they, you know, go a little more arcadey with it, I'm into it. But I don't, you know, I'm not immediately turned off by it or whatever. The people that just don't like RPGs, they're the ones I don't understand. Because the whole world of games, the entire game world has adopted RPG elements. So there is no more on the fence with that. Like, you can't just say I hate RPGs, because then what you're saying is you hate Call of Duty, you hate anything with progression in it. They all have stolen RPG ideas. So every game in the world's got some form of progression in it, be it overtly RPG or not. And that's just the world we live in, and I think it's great. I think it's the greatest thing ever. But there are people who really don't like that. But thanks for the call, man. I really appreciate hearing from you. Thank you guys for calling in. We've got time for one more if anybody wants to make that call. Looks like phones are ready. There we go. Real quick, people can't stop making memes about that Untitled Goose Game. Very popular little piece of business showed up on Steam, I'm trying to say, and the Switch. See what I did there? Steam and the Switch. So I said Twitch. Been on Twitch a lot too, but anyway. This thing is ridiculously popular. Nobody can stop playing it. I have not got it yet, so I guess I'm not in that group yet, but I would like to possibly be in that group. But the memes it is producing have been crazy. They've been flocking to this game as if it's like raw meme juice. It's also a pretty big hit, and you spend the majority of this game solving puzzles, getting in all sorts of mischief, because you're a freaking goose. Geese are terrible. I don't know if I've made this clear before, but I've never had a good relationship with a goose. They're all a-holes. They honk. They annoy me. There's a couple over here at the lake I just want to murder. I'd never kill an innocent animal, but if a goose comes after me, I might have to change my ways. Anyway. It's pretty cool, and the absurdity that has come from it in terms of memes and stuff has been pretty crazy. So I'm just going to recommend you go check out this UpRocks article at uprocks.com/gaming/untitledgoosegamememes. If you can't find it that way, just search for it. But so many great memes, so many people having so much fun with this. Who knew this would take off the way it has? It has been an enormous success for the developer. In fact, I think the New York Times had an article about it today. The freaking New York Times had an article on their newspaper about Untitled Goose Game. That's when you know you've hit pay dirt, I think, as a small indie game developer. So well done to those guys. All right, I think it's going to do it for today's inaugural episode, test episode of this here thing. The Frog Pants Plays News Update, which I hope you enjoyed. I enjoyed being here, and I look forward to doing it again tomorrow. We'll keep banging through it, figure out what I want it to be. Again, it's primarily a streaming thing. So the goal is to get you guys here for the live stream and to be a part of it, to drop your subs and support it and be the backbone of it. And your feedback is always welcome. I would love to hear from each of you what you think about it, and what we do moving forward depends a lot on what you like. I'll see you guys a little bit later. Thanks for being here. We'll see you then. This show is part of the Frog Pants Network. Frog Pants Network. Get more shows like this at frogpants.com.